बाय डॉक्टर सुशील गाकंड की। नाउ ओवर टू डॉक्टर सुंदरराम शेट्टी सर।
You please unmute.
हेलो।
वी कैन हियर यू डॉक्टर शेट्टी, वी कैन हियर यू।
या गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। सो एज यू नो कैप्सुलर एक्सिस इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट स्टेप इन एनी कैटरेक्ट सर्जरी। सो डोंट बी अंडर द इम्प्रेशन दैट सीसीसी इज एन ऑप्शनल इन एसएससीएस। आई वुड से इट्स मैंडेटरी इन अ सेंस। There is always a tendency among our, the beginners who are learning cataract surgery while doing SACS, they think that, capsular excess, if you get it, is fine, or if you don't get it, it's also fine. Yes, you can continue doing an SACS even without the capsular excess, but in the long run, a capsular excess, that is the CCC, will give you the maximum stability of the IOL with so many other added benefits, including the size and shape of the pupil and the PCO factor, everything. And also it increases the safety of the surgery in terms of cortical aspiration, wherein the risk of catching the capsule is reduced almost to zero, and a complete polishing of the capsule is also possible if we do CCC. So for CCC, the prerequisite would be to relax the anterior capsule. In a state of rest, anterior capsule is in stretch. So it has to be relaxed due to the centrifugal force from the zonules. The capsule is under stretch. So this centrifugal force has to be neutralized. So the first pearl is to increase the anterior chamber pressure so that the bulge of the anterior capsule is reduced and it is zonules are relaxed, because if you see anatomically, the dome of the anterior capsule is higher than the zonular plane. So you have to push the anterior capsule or the whole cataract down so that the zonules relax, so that the anterior chamber becomes deep and the anterior capsule becomes relaxed. In cases where there are occasions like intumescent lens or the hypermature cataracts, you may have an increased intralenticular pressure. In such cases, we will have to reduce the intralenticular pressure by different means we used earlier in the last meet. So that is my first prerequisite to do an CCC. So the second point would be to do this CCC under a closed chamber or almost closed chamber. You are all listening to me, no? Hello?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. Because I won't know until, I am continuing. So next point would be try to do the rexis under a closed chamber, for which nothing like irrigating cystitome or a cystitome loaded loaded to 2 ml syringe with the BSS or ringer lactate and you know, make a puncture on the floor of the tunnel and increase the enteric chamber pressure, relax the enteric capsule, and do the RECCIS. It's a totally closed chamber technique wherein there is no leak, and anterior chamber pressure is positive and enteric capsule is relaxed. Only here you have the fluid in the enteric chamber, which is against people are so familiar with viscoelastic in the enteric chamber. But this is also a beautiful technique to do it under BSS or ringer lactate. And and it will be floating in the, not like the in the case of viscoelastic, it is flat on the enteric capsule and it is wrinkled and folded that you can't sometimes make out exactly where the tear is going. Point number three would be, of course, the cystitome. If we are using the cystitome, using the capsule or RECCIS forceps, then the chances of losing the enteric chamber is higher. But nowadays you have this micro forceps, which are, you know, which pass through a very small opening. But, you know, I have yet to see one which is very comfortable in my hand. So the option of doing CCC under air is there. For years, you know, Dr. Ravindra used to show us how to do it under air and used to do it so beautifully. I must have done over 100,000 surgeries under BSS or ringer lactate. My technique is irrigating cystitome. So that works beautifully. And the option of viscoelastic has come along with, you know, when we make a 2.8 mm entry, we can do it from there or from the side port. Point number four would be the size. What is the size of the RECCIS you would like to do? Chetan, you are looking very nice now today. It's your picture, I think. What is the size? Size, you know, ideally would be 0.5 millimeter overlap of the enteric capsule over the optic of the IOL, that is to the centering and reduce the PCO. Of course, Dr. Ravindra will challenge it right away, I know that, but then this is how I believe in. And remember, the non-zoolar area of the anterior capsule is about 6.5 millimeter. So if any RECCIS bigger than that, you definitely are going to go to the zonular area, from where you will find it difficult to, you know, proceed with the RECCIS, and the tendency for it to go to the periphery is higher, and there will be more resistance for the tear to progress. So we are looking at about 5 to 5.5 if the optic of the IOL is 6 mm. So, but as we know, the RECCIS need to be little bigger than in FACO in SACS, because the nucleus has to come out in toto, out of the back into the anterior chamber before we deliver it. So for which we need a slightly on the bigger side. But remember, the perimeter of the RECCIS is stretchable.
2 minutes to go.
Yeah, how much it can stretch? It can stretch up to 1/3 of its perimeter. So a healthy RECCIS is a stretchable, you know, circle which we can make use of at the time of delivering the nucleus into the enteric chamber. We know that the elasticity will reduce if you use a trypan blue, but you have to keep that in mind. So I do not think that one should go on using trypan blue when you can really see the clear capsule very well. Only in mature, hypermature cataracts you can use. And while getting this RECCIS in the to a proper center, we can take the reference of the pupillary margin. If you see that the pupil is nicely dilated and it is circular, then you can use the reference of the edge of the pupillary margin to get the pupil, you know, circular or CCC circular. And the last point I would make is the how do you start the rexis? You know, we know that start from the center, you know, go right or left by half the, you know, the radius of the rexis you want to make and make a turn. So remember, it is like driving a car. You can't turn the car 90 degree. So you better, you know, start the rotatory movement or, you know, folding the flap and start the rexis before it reaches the required radius, so that it will be slightly, you know, semicircular, you know, line, which will subsequently become the CCC. So it will not tear 90 degree at the tip of the or end of this cut we make. So also, and when it is a small cut, I say that is about 1.5 mm or 2 mm, it is more difficult to, you know, lift it. Then it's a longer. If you have to make it longer, do not make it on the towards the pupil. Instead, you do it at the other end. That is from center, you go off center, you know, beyond the center on the other side, so that you get a longer cut to lift. So that is the, I think, the last point I would like to make. And any questions on this, I will be happy to answer. Thank you very much. Dev?
Yeah, please.
So can we start the second session, sir? The all the equations can be taken.
Dr. Dev can start his presentation.
Okay, I'll share my screen now.
Dr. Dev, you need to unmute.
Yeah, I'm unmuted. Is my slides visible?
It's visible now. You can start.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Today's my talk is going to be on just a small topic on my way of nucleus management. Nucleus management, as you know, that it is one of the prime step wherein the nucleus is managed adequately so that the next or the future steps go smoothly. And whenever a trainee comes to learn SISS, there are a few steps which are very easy. For example, putting a bridle suture or superior bridle suture, conjunctival peritomy, or collapsing the nucleus out of from the anterior chamber into the outside, placing the IOL in the back. All these things are easier steps. The most difficult steps are the creating the pseudocorneal tunnel, making a good continuous curvilinear capsular axis, and then collapsing the nucleus out of the blood bag. Today, so before going ahead with the nucleus management, I would like to stress on two pearls. One is the crescent. When you are making a pseudocorneal tunnel, always ensure that the heel of the crescent should be always flat on the blade, so that you can just the crescent blade is just visible through the sclera. And whenever using a keratome, always tilt it downward. Movement should be forward and lateral so that you are cutting it only while going inside. And finally, the internal incision should be always parallel to the lumbus. This will ensure that the sclerocorneal tunnel is very strong enough and the spiral, the tunnel effect is not lost. So what are the prerequisites for a good nucleus management? The first and foremost is a well-dilated pupil. Ideally, around 7 to 8 mm pupil would be a good case to operate upon. And there should be an adequate tunnel. The tunnel with the sense is adequate sclerocorneal tunnel, wherein there is sclera and the corneal entry is appropriately managed. And then you should always aim for a good large continuous curvilinear capsules. If your excess is very large, it is 90% sure that the nucleus is going to come out very smoothly. And when there is a good large CCC, the another point is a cortical cleaving iododissection. When the saline passes into the along the bent anterior capsule, it cleaves around the cortex and the posterior capsule, leaving just collapsing the nucleus outside of the bag. And thing we should ensure is always maintain a deep anterior chamber by using a copious amount of viscoelastics. It could be either hyaluronic acid or it could be HPMC. So whenever you're taking, when you're talking about nucleus management, the two barriers which come into mind are the endothelium and the posterior capsule. The endothelium, which is the anterior part, which you have to be preserved, which cannot be pardoned off. And the next is the posterior capsule. Posterior capsule should always be kept concave by using a lot of viscoelastics. If these two barriers are managed, the nucleus can be easily collapsed. So there are a lot of techniques described by many, many stalwarts. But the most famous and the most frequently followed is the phaco sandwich method, the irrigating vectors, the intratenal phaco fracture, the Blumenthal technique, the visco expression, or the phaco section, or a fish hook, or using a 30G needle. I'll just show my technique of doing a
We can't hear you.
Yeah, 1 second.
Sir, one more request, sir. I think there is background sound from Dev sir only, sir. Can you just close the door?
One second.
We are hearing a TV sound and
one second. Yeah, are you able to see my video now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Wherein sideboard is made and the caps. Once the capsular axis is fashioned, a circular capsular axis is fashioned, the next step make a sclerocorneal tunnel. So the congenital peritomy is done with a. And then a velocity of cataract. I just make a straight incision on the sclera. Inside the sclera, through bringing or to and fro motion, so that. And then in the same plane, just go a little upwards into the cornea. It can accommodate into the scleral tunnel and it can be prolapsed out. So once that is done, then the AC is entered with a keratome and iododissection is going to be a little easier. So you just take a hydrocannula, then go under the anterior capsule. You make count of BSS. So once that is done, the anterior chamber. If it doesn't prolapse, then you can repeat the same step into the opposite pole. And once it as a Sinsky, and then make space and just tilt the nucleus. And you can insert the wire vectors or the wire vectors, and then prolapse the nucleus outside. Nucleus, if you have done a proper iododissection, it easily comes out in one go, or else you need to prolapse it. If pressure is given, the epinucleus just gushes out in one shot. I do my nucleus management. Yeah, tell me.
The audio is breaking, sir. Your video. The presenting video, surgical video, let it be there, sir. Only the your video, so that the bandwidth get improved.
Yeah.
Hello.
The video is playing.
The video is playing, sir.
Yeah. Okay. The cortical is cortex is just washed off from the sideboard and from the main wound, so that Once that is done, then the next step is just implanting the rigid IOL in the Simcoe cannula with the continuum of the back. Okay, once this is done,
voice is breaking, sir.
So that's how I want to end my presentation. So I would like to take.
Dr. Dev, we have seen an excellent video.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Stop sharing. My last request, Dr. Nagaraju and Kiran Kumar, to start the discussion. Dr. Nagaraj?
Good evening, everybody. Dr. Dev, that was an excellent video. And
thank
a
you,
lot
sir.
Of
thank
important
you,
points you gave, actually. I think since there are a lot of postgraduates here, we have to give them some simple tips like nucleus is not just a nucleus. See, basically, crystalline lens consists of nucleus, your epinucleus, and cortical matter. So I think it is better to categorize these three things: management of the nucleus, management of the epinucleus, and cortical matter. That everything was done properly only, but when you tell, it is better you precisely tell what step you are managing. It is cataract, what you have. You can choose your hydro procedure also. Am I audible?
Yes,
sir.
Yeah. That is one thing. And most importantly, all the postgraduates here should realize, SICS, all the procedures, that is the nuclear procedures, we are going to do outside the bag. That is one important thing. Second thing is nucleus management in SICS consists of two steps, actually. One is delivering the nucleus into the anterior chamber and delivering the nucleus from the anterior chamber outside. These are the two steps which you have to differentiate, and each step is different. And basically, there are various techniques which have been described for nucleus management, especially once you bring the nucleus into the anterior chamber, depending upon whether you bring out the nucleus in toto, like your Blumenthal technique, the entire nucleus is brought out. Expression technique, that is, there is one cannula called the Corydon cannula. With that, we can do a visco expression, and we can bring the entire nucleus outside. These are few techniques wherein you bring the entire nucleus outside. There are other techniques where we bisect the nucleus. Earlier terminology was phaco fracture. That was, I think, the term which was proposed by Peter Kansas. But since it looks very traumatic, I think then they changed it over to phaco section or phaco fragmentation. It can be either a bisection, trisection, or a multi-fragmentation also. And other techniques are also available, wherein you don't have to bring the entire nucleus in toto. The technique which you described between two instruments and take it out. And most of the time, please, can you elaborate how you insert the wire vectis into the anterior chamber? Can you just precisely explain for the benefit of postgraduates here? Can you just describe what should be the ideal type of vectis you should have?
And it should lodge the nucleus, concave part of the vectis. It performs a sandwich, and then you press the posterior lip of the wound, and then you
Dr. Dev, I think you're muted.
I just, yeah. The thing is, the vectors, we have the rough edges of the cage, the nucleus in the inferior pole, and then with the Sinsky, you can just place it over the nucleus so that a sandwich is formed, and then you can remove it in toto by just pressing the posterior lip.
One more important point I would like to just add to your thing is, once you insert the vectus beneath the nucleus, sometimes invariably you displace a little bit of viscoelastic outside. For a beginner, it is always better after that step, let them inject a little bit of more viscoelastic above the nucleus before inserting the Sinsky hook or your bisector or trisector, whatever it is. And can you just explain to us, how do you exactly put the insert the Sinsky hook inside above the nucleus for your phacosandrum?
I think Dr. Sundaram Chetty wants to say something. He's raised
his
hand.
Yeah.
No, can we add points to this, or it is only between Nagaraju and Dev?
I think everybody can contribute, sir.
But all are muted.
I think we can unmute whenever we want to talk something.
No, it is with the host. We can't unmute ourselves.
No, you can unmute. All the people can unmute during discussion. It's enabled.
Enabled down. Thank you. Dev, all your presentation was disturbed by your background noise. Was it so difficult to eliminate that? We could hardly hear what you said, and you being the host, I thought yours would be the most hitch-free presentation. You are muted now. You have to unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I tried my best, sir, but the bandwidth is very low here, so I couldn't do much.
No, there was so much of noise from behind. I know which.
No, I'm using a microphone. I'm using it.
No, the challenge to keep your our attention to your presentation. Recti, the flat thing. It is a. You can't hear me.
We can hear you, sir.
Okay, so it is like a discus. It's a disc which is thicker in the center. So when you are passing the vectis, we know that vectis also has a curve. So that if you hold it like this, tip of the vectis actually is looking little angulated. It's not looking forward. So we have to guide the vectis in such a way that it doesn't jam the posterior surface of the nucleus. So, and also remember that the nucleus is translucent. Actually, you can see the vectis going under the nucleus all the way. And the best way is to just follow the posterior surface of the nucleus. Don't lose sight of the tip of the vectis. If it goes deeper, then you lose sight of the vectis. That means you are going towards the posterior capsule. So at the point of entry, you can use the second instrument, the dialer or whatever the bisection you are going to do with, you can actually hold the edge of the nucleus a little up so that the tip of the vectis is going under the nucleus. And before the vectis starts going forward, take the dialer to the center of the nucleus and study the nucleus and keep it away from the endothelium. If you take the dialer after you have put the vectis, by the time the nucleus would have abutted the posterior surface or the endothelial surface of the cornea. And by then, if you try to put the dialer, you are going to cause too much of damage to the endothelium. And also remember the vectis that we are using, you have a look at the vectis, it should not be like us, pier shape. It should be slightly wider near the tip. Otherwise, if it is widest at the center of your whole vectis, then the tip of the vectis has to go too far to get the widest part of the vectis. So there are chances of this vectis catching the iris. You select a vectis wherein the widest part is near the tip. And this widest part should be at the center of the posterior surface of the nucleus, so that it will be very stably sitting on the vectis when you are holding or sandwiching it with the dialer. Remember, while delivering the nucleus, do not press the two instruments too much. You may break the nucleus if that was not the intention. And also use the tunnel perfectly or optimally. In a sense, make this nucleus come through the middle of the tunnel. Let it not go to one side or to the other, or let it not come in an angle. So the bring out the instrument such a way that it is parallel to the two sides of the tunnel, so that you use the full width of the tunnel. Many a times you would have done a nice big tunnel, but the nucleus gets stuck at the pillar because we are withdrawing it in an angle. So this also should be avoided, so that, and the dialer's function is not just to catch the nucleus, it is to keep the nucleus away from the endothelium. Theoretically, only the inner lip, edge of the inner lip should be touching this instrument and the nucleus and nothing else. Thank you.
Dr. Sundaram, can I ask you a question?
Yep.
There are various types of vectis available. Do you prefer a vectis with a smooth anterior edge, or do you prefer a corrugated vectis?
Serrated one. Serrated one sometimes can put you in trouble, because when you want to withdraw it, you cannot withdraw it without causing, you know, damage to the posterior surface of the nucleus. Mm. So I would prefer a plain one rather than the serrated one. And so also to maintain and cleaning also, you know, it will slowly, quickly becomes, you know, rusted and all that.
Yeah. And one more the point which I would like to mention, especially in a place where there are multiple users, it is always better to feel the posterior part of the vectis before you insert, because sometimes if the vectis has fallen down and it is traumatized, sometimes if it is damaged, if you try to insert a vectis, such a vectis, you might end up with a post-capsule rupture.
So I'll take one more minute just to tell how I, you know, categorize what type of nuclear delivery I want to go, want to do is on the density of the nucleus. If it is a zero or grade one nucleus, I would do a visco expression. If it is grade 1, 2, 3, I do a sandwich technique. And anything, you know, harder than that, then I will do a phaco section and deliver the nucleus. So this way, it is not that you have to practice the same thing on every grade of cataract. Accordingly, we can plan. But as long as the last part, the harder ones are there, you have two options. That is, either you modify the tunnel to suit your nucleus, size of the nucleus, or you modify the nucleus to suit the size of your tunnel.
What is the size of your scleral tunnel, Dr. Sundaram?
I always like to make it 6 mm so that I have the option of using the rigid lens also.
Sir, Dr. Ravindra, sir, your tips on phaco section?
Sundar has given, excellent add-ons to, you got to go up in the direction of the tunnel by a millimeter or two, then you go down. And before you actually do this, inject visco, like always we are worried about endothelium. So we inject a lot of visco in front of the endothelium, in front of the nucleus to separate it from the endothelium. And their HPMC is the best visco. There's nothing superior to HPMC because that is a dispersive viscoelastic. In addition to that, also put little amount of viscoelastic behind the nucleus so that your passage of wire vectors is easier before you pass it. Most of the youngsters, as I've seen, they are worried about posterior capsule. So their plane of insertion of wire vectors is much anterior. In that, they're hitting the convexity of the lens and lens moves downwards. So at any point of time, watch the lens, center of the nucleus should be in the center of the cornea. If it tends to move downwards, that is your plane is not correct. You have to go a little more behind. Do not worry about posterior capsule. It's very, very difficult to tear with the wire vectors. I don't think I've ever done it. So your plane has to be curvaceous. Once you remove the nucleus, see the nucleus from sideways. It's got a curve. It's a steep curve from periphery to middle of the nucleus. You have to follow that curve when you're passing it. So visco will lubricate that area, give a space there. The next is see that the nucleus is not moving downwards or away from you. If you're sitting temporarily, it should not be moving away from you towards the nasal side. These are 2 points I would like to say. And the viral vector should be tear-shaped. You know, as you know, Sundaram Shetty beautifully said, it's like a teardrop, upside teardrop. The why is that it's narrow towards you, towards the stem? It is narrow towards the stems because if it's a smaller nucleus, sometimes nucleus tries to go through that. If you imagine you've got a circular wide viral vector, nucleus tries to go down through it, especially you've bisected it, and then it may go actually in the space between corneal valve and this iris. It may not be coming out. So if it is tapered towards the handle, then it prevents the herniation of a small nucleus or a soft nucleus through the viral vector behind. The other thing beautifully mentioned is viral vector. Once I remember in my career, the viral vector was like that, but it was broken there. It was broken. Because it was attached like that, I was unable to see. So there's a very nice point. You always palpate the back portion or the front portion. See, it's not broken. And once it has happened, and that can, you know, when you bisect it, then it can go open up, you can catch a tissue, and you may be pulling out the intraocular tissues along with that. So the assistant who washes the instruments has got a tremendous role to see that she keeps good instruments. It's nice to see all instruments under microscope, including colibri, before you actually apply it. Make it a habit to inspect the instruments under microscope before you actually use it. So that's a very good point Dr. Nagaraj just pointed out. And these are the and viral vectors. It should be as thin as it's possible. See, viral vectors has a space. Imagine you've got a thick viral vectors, thick, you know, on both sides. It itself is occupying space, and that amount of space in the tunnel is reduced for your nucleus to come out. So have as thin a viral vectors as is possible. So these are a couple of points that I would like to share.
It was excellent listening to Dr. Sundaram, sir. Sir, I had a question for you. These things and all, like, holds good when we have like a proper dilated pupil with a very large rexus of about like 5 to 5.5 or 6 millimeter with good iodo dissection. The cake will be ready to come out. But what about in extreme situations like a smaller pupil or loose zonules? To deliver nucleus, sir, do you modify your technique, sir? Nucleus delivery in subluxated lenses or loose zonules, do you modify your technique? Hello, am I audible, sir?
You're audible. I think maybe Dr. Sundaram Shetty has to unmute.
Dr. Kiran, you can continue commenting something else.
MS, sir, like, can you no. just
yeah. okay. put some light on this? I am unmuted in, now. See,
yeah, so what should we do, like, when the pupil is around like 3.5 or 4.5 millimeter with a small irregular rexus?
Before that,
with a lot of capsular additions, like, should we have to do something for making a proper route for the nucleus to deliver out?
Yeah, the point which was not discussed much is how do we deliver the nucleus out of the bag?
Yeah.
So time and again, you know, it has been passed. In a sense, it is how it will come out. Every time when you do hydrodissection, don't expect the nucleus to get out of the bag. There has to be a proper technique to mobilize the nucleus out of the bag. Now, for my technique, I use two instruments, that is a repositor and a dialer. I have to put the dialer in the center of the nucleus after the hydrodissection. The nucleus is loose in the bag. And before that, my hydrodissection itself, my objective of the hydrodissection is not to just loosen the nucleus in the bag. I want the edge of the nucleus to lift from the bag. That is the ideal endpoint for me, which many times it will not happen. Most of the time it happens. Now, if it happens, then the repositor goes under the edge of that lifted nucleus edge, and with the dialer, I rotate the nucleus out of the bag. Supposing it has not come out, but it is loose in the bag, then what I do, I use the repositor to if I'm using the dialer in the right hand, the left hand, the repositor goes to the edge of the rexis. I stretch it towards the periphery, towards the limbus. Simultaneously, the dialer pulls the nucleus to the right, so that a point will come where the edge of the nucleus will be within the repositor, meaning to the right of the repositor. I can feel it because there is no resistance of the hard nucleus under my repositor. That is when I dip the repositor and take the repositor under the edge of this nucleus and lift it. It did not happen spontaneously. I make it happen mechanically or manually. Once it is lifted, I quickly come out and put visco and prevent this nucleus from going back, push the capsular back down. That is the starting point. You put the repositor under this nucleus, which is lifted out of the bag, and let not go back, and use the dialer to the edge of the nucleus and rotate it over it and make the whole of the nucleus come into the anterior chamber. This, I think Mallikarjun, no, asked the question.
Kiran.
Yes. So now this can be done whatever the size of the pupil. Once you have mobilized it into the out of the bag, same can be done to the small pupil also. What you have done to the nucleus which is in the bag to come out of the bag, same technique can be used to make it come into the anterior chamber. I do not think that we have to use any hooks or those rings to make the pupil big to get the nucleus into the anterior chamber. And of course, the adherent and all those situations, I do not sit on the idea of getting a rexis. I don't mind using scissors to make the anterior capsulotomy and then get the nucleus out. There is no problem there. I mean, as far as I am concerned.
Thank you, sir. Is the same method do we use for subluxator lens also? Can we put so much of stress in the bag when there is about 90 to 120 degree subluxation with weak zonules? Or should we have to go for any capsular support?
Dr. Kiran, I think that next video is about that only.
I'll just do a video if it will explain what you have said. I'll just try to open one video. Is that visible now?
Ah, sir, your screen is visible.
Visible?
Yes, it's visible.
So it'll take only a minute or so. That is, I've done a tunnel there. And my left eye...
No, sir, your video is not visible.
Video
only
has to open.
You have to show the screen. You're not showing the screen.
Share the screen.
You are selected the file, I think, again.
Correct. Yeah, I wanted to show only the file.
You have to close and share screen and then open it.
Yeah, I thought I'll do something else this time. Is that visible now?
Yeah. Now you can play the movie, it will be visible. Yes.
Yeah.
So what I'm holding, as Dr. Sundaram Shetty elegantly told, that's a rexis, which is about 5 millimeter, just soft nucleus, not a very dense nucleus, to look at onset clamp. My left hand has got a sense cube, right hand has got, instead of a sense cube, I use a 25 gauge cannula. This 25 gauge cannula is held in such a way that I'm continuously injecting viscoelastic throughout, and I'm rotating it. See, the center of the nucleus remains in the center of the nucleus. If you push nucleus by 1 millimeter, what's going to happen? The edge rim of the nucleus, if the nucleus is pushing the whole mass on this side. So imagine that, it's like the wheel of a car, the steering wheel, and you're rotating with two hands, you see? Then what I've done is, I'll just explain a little more behind. What I've done is, Dr. Sundaram Shetty explained this. I'll just show you step by step. I've rotated it now. And to rotate, where does it rotate? It rotates, you've done a capsular separating hydrodissection that separates the capsular edge from the cortex. That's now nothing to do, irrelevant to the nuclear management. Now, when it rotates at a plane between the cortex and epinucleus. So that's the plane it's used. It doesn't rotate at the plane between the cortex and capsule. It rotates at a plane where epinucleus and cortex meets. That's the loosest point for it to rotate. Then push the nucleus little to the left side. As you push it little to the left side, this fellow, this end of it will raise. As you get, I go underneath it, just like you do a horizontal chop. I'm not doing a chop, but then you go to the periphery, go under the epinucleus and nucleus and put your cannula underneath that. Don't worry about posterior capsule, which is separated from the capsule. It's separated from the nucleus and the tip of your cannula by the whole of cortex. And now lift it up. And then walk on the edge. I always call it as walk on the edge, so that you know you lift it up and walk it. I'll show you again. Walk with two instruments. Lift it up and walk now. And as you're walking, you have little traction on this side, so the nucleus comes to the side. By the time you walk 2 clock hours, if your aim is correct, then your entire nucleus is out. So initially push to the left side. As you're pushing to the left side, this corner lifts up, go underneath that, lift it up, then ensure that the center of the nucleus, epinucleus is in the center all the time. You're not pushing it anywhere. And then you are handed. This is a different type of mini vectis, which you know, I'm bisecting it and taking it out. That's not relevant. But now what is relevant is the... What is relevant is the question that you know beautifully it was raised by Dr. Deepak and Dr. Nagaraju. How do you lift it from the capsular back? So where did I learn? When I had my car tire punctured, I went to a puncture shop way back, maybe 25, 30 years ago. A beautiful young boy who lifted the tire rim out of the capsular back. Tire rim is smaller than the tire is smaller than the rim. So he puts a lever it under it and lifts it up. And he has got such a magical hand, in no time, the entire tire is out of the rim. So I watched that. I said, if he can do it, why not be? So that's the starting point of lifting it up and rotating it, like unscrewing. Actually, you're unscrewing. The nucleus comes out of the capsular back. Hope I'm clear with that. Yeah, Dr. Deepak, you wanted to say?
Yeah, no, it was very clear. Very clear. Can we move to the next talk?
Next talk is by Dr. Sushil Kakanki.
Sir, it is showing host disabled. Can you allow me to share my screen?
Yeah, you can just click on the share screen.
Because Dev sir's net is not that.
No, you only have to share the screen. You can share the screen.
Try doing that now. Dr. Sushil, try doing that
share
now.
Share the screen. It is showing. Now it is showing host disabled participant screen sharing.
Now you try it again. Participants are allowed to share screen.
Very unfriendly host.
No, can I share the screen? Can I try? I have downloaded your file. Sushil.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Sushil, yes, sir.
I have downloaded your file. Can I share it and you can speak?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Question, sir. By then. Shetty, sir?
Yes, Chetan.
Sir, you said you can see the vectus in most of the times. What if the cataract is very hard? How do we actually know that we are just under the nucleus and not under the iris or, you know, under the anterior capsule? I mean, can you just throw some light on that?
I think the video started now.
Yeah, hold on. I will come back once this is over.
Okay, Sushil, you can start commenting.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Sushil. I'll be showing two of my cases in where I ended up with a zonular dialysis. So this was a this is the first case. This was an intumescent cataract. And usually what happens in intumescent cataract is, for a beginner like me, we have that phobia of running off of our rexus. So usually we end up doing a small rexus in intumescent cataracts. So the same thing what I did in this case, I did a very small rexus of around 5 to 5.5 millimeters. So ideally we need to do a rexus of 6 to 6.5 millimeters as Sundaram Shetty sir told. So the nucleus was removed easily out of the bag. Usually what happens is after a hydro dissection, the nucleus pops out of the bag or it starts rotating. And usually with the cartwheeling, it easily comes out. So unknowingly, we during our initial phase, unknowingly, we put a undue pressure on the bag and we exert a pressure on the bag that will ultimately that ends up with zonular dialysis. So the same thing happened in this case also. So we can see that zonular dialysis, this is a temporal incision which I have taken. And you can see that there's a zonular dialysis from 8 o'clock to 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock position. So in this case, the pupil was constricted. There was no vitreous disturbance. Clean cortical wash was given. And the pupil was constricted with a pilocarpine. And I placed the iris claw lens in this case. So usually I feel for a beginner like me, it is very important to record our surgeries because we'll come to know where we have gone wrong. So, and in cataract surgery, each step is so important that the step you complicate will complicate your subsequent steps. Like if you complicate with a small tunnel, you end up with a problem with the nucleus delivery. If you do a small rexus, you end up with a zonular dialysis like this. Because these things we will come to know only if we record our surgeries. So this is the second case which I'm showing. This was a hypermature cataract. I did a small rexus in this case. I did a rexus for 3 times in this case. So I decompressed my nucleus. Secondary rexus was done, which was again, it was a small rexus. And again, I did a rexus for 3 times. Then also I didn't do a adequate rexus. So after nucleus delivery, I noticed there was something was floating. And again, in this case, I ended up with a big zonular dialysis of around more than 180 degrees. Sometimes what misleads us is like once after hydro dissection, the nucleus starts rotating. It's one pole prolapses out and we feel that we are on the safer side and we start cartwheeling the nucleus to get it out of the bag. And we end up with zonular dialysis. You can see that around 6 o'clock position, I'm exerting much pressure on the bag. And ultimately, I ended up with a zonular dialysis. So the nucleus was safely removed with an adequate tunnel through visco expression. And a clean cortical wash was given. And the pupil was constricted and it was managed with iris, by constricting the pupil, iris claw lens was placed. So you can see that there's a zonular dialysis from 4 o'clock to 12 o'clock, 9 o'clock. This is a temporal incision. So can you hear my audio?
Sure, very well.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, MS sir, I think you need to comment. And Dr. Preeti was supposed to comment. She's not here. So I'll be commenting beside instead of her. Sir.
Yeah, I think wonderful videos. I should compliment about the skills that you have. marvelous. I would rate them as one of the best videos. I think what I saw was your approach was excellent, that the you try to make the Lexis as big as it's possible. And then the only way I would like to differ from you is you try to rotate the nucleus single-handedly with one instrument. Yes. So whenever you're rotating it, you see, if you can play the first video, I can show you. If you can try to push, play Dr. Deepak, can you play the first video? And every time you are rotating it, there is a pressure by one edge of the nucleus on the capsular back.
Yes.
So it has torn exactly in the opposite direction. So you've drawn the capsular back zonules too much. So all these, like what are the cases that have big zonules? We know pseudo exfoliation. We know the, what do you call it, the mature, hypermature cataracts with very large nuclear mass is very large. And small pupils and past uveitis injury, all of them will have big zonules. You should be aware of it. The number one hint that you rightly mentioned is having a very large Lexis. That's of paramount importance. Forget about overlapping and all. I would, Sundaram Shetty did mention about it. Ensure that the lens is inside the bag, but forget about the size of the Lexis. Never try to manage this with a smaller Lexis. In the first session, we also discussed about known Lexis. Instead of a round Lexis, you can intentionally make. So you don't want to run peripherally the entire circumference, at least at 2 points or 3 points, you run to the periphery and come back to the center. So you have better grasp on the anterior capsule and the Lexis. Can you play the video, Dr. Deepak, the first video?
Yes.
Little behind, backwards. Yeah. So where he rotates the nucleus. The other thing is, I would not like to do a hydrodissection at all for these patients where the cataract is very large. See, now all these movements, this is a beautiful way of prolapsing it out of it, but then the plane of the nucleus is not horizontal, not flat. At some point of time, the right side pole has dipped inside, left side pole has. Now we can see here, the Lexis, the capsular zonular distensation has happened at that point. So where the pressure was too much probably. And I would like to ask Dr. Deepak, you would put a ring in this patient.
Yes,
from this point of time, when there's no vitreous loss, when there is a zonular dehiscence of 1/4, maybe 3 clock hours or maybe a little less than 3 clock hours, how do you stop here and manage? You're doing an SICS.
Now this is the point the nucleus has come out now. This is exactly the point where the nucleus has come out. Okay. So now we are seeing a zonular dehiscence of 3 clock hours here. Okay. And the first thing to do here is to use a viscoelastic to form the bag, to push the fornices back forward. Instead of what Dr. Sushil did was he went with a Simco cannula. And that is not to be done actually. So what I would have done differently here would be, okay, I have identified a zonular dehiscence here. You still have opportunity to put the lens into the bag. So you don't lose this opportunity now. So you don't want to extend the area of zonular dehiscence. Use a viscoelastic to form the bag, preferably sodium hyaluronate, because it expands the bag and you create the fornice. It's like an artificial ring there. You expand the bag there, then you insert a ring, and then you put a 6 millimeter rigid lens or whatever lens, it goes beautifully into the bag. And luckily there was no vitreous disturbance, obviously. So still you had more the opportunity to put the lens into the bag. And now coming on to the, again, the reason why it happened.
Just to stop you at this point of time, this is exactly what you're seeing. Imagine that on the screen, there's a 12 o'clock, forget about the temporal, 12 o'clock, 3 and 6, 9. When would you start injecting? Would you go through the main port or if there is a side port, you go through?
No, I would create a side port here. If it is not there, I would put my cannula inside here and then put the viscoelastic at this point so that the bag inflates and it just goes in here rather than going in like this. If you go in like this, your cannula might go behind the zonular dehiscence area. So I would want to go from this area, put in viscoelastic here, and preferably sodium hyaluronate, because that creates space. You don't want to put HPMC. You can do with HPMC as well, but the safety margin is higher with sodium hyaluronate. Use a put it here and push it back. And then you have a deep bag here.
Dr. Deepak, would you like to use both the sodium hyaluronate as well as convergent sulfate to have a sorption technique. Because the sodium hydronate, the moment you take synchro cannula, entire thing is out. It comes like
Yes, sir. But what to do is before that, I would want to put a ring. So that ring is going to prevent the bag from being floppy and come out. So that is a trick here.
How do you start you putting the ring in this particular patient?
So you form the bag from here, you put in viscoelastic, make the chamber deep here, the capsular bag deep here, and introduce the CTR from this end. And it is go like this, and then tampon in this area, and then it comes like this. And I preferably use a second side port here to compress the ring so that it doesn't exert zonules on the stress on the healthy zonules there. So that's the idea.
Okay.
What may I? What caused the zonular dehiscence here? I do not think it is the during the delivery of the nucleus to the anterior chamber. Maybe his technique of visco expression might have caused this dehiscence.
But sir, I felt maybe it was just the way it, the forceful with which it came out into the anterior chamber. That single-handed technique, I thought, was the reason.
Can you play it again, doctor?
Yeah, we'll see.
Just a little bit.
Because the rexis is so big.
Now he is drawing it. Now, this is the point. By chance, if that instrument is holding, like in the 7 o'clock, he put the cannula and moved the nucleus towards the center. You can go back again, you can see that. Imagine that cannula was actually sitting not on the nucleus, but on the capsule there. Little more behind Dr. Deepak. Now let it run. Hydrodissection. There, that point. So if he's holding it at any point of time on the capsule, that's one reason. Geographically looking at that's one of the reasons. Continue.
And at this point also, when he's pushing the visco, that point also could have been responsible for that area, because that's the area which is now become dehiscent there. That, as Dr. Shetty sir was telling, so both the reasons could be a possibility here, I guess.
Beautiful video, beautiful recording. And
your quality of recording is very good, Sushil. I must compliment you for that.
Thank you, sir.
And about a small take-home message about the iris claw lens. Iris claw lens is, in my opinion, one of the best lenses to rehabilitate these patients. You have used Sinsky hooks to enclavate the thing, but I would have preferred to use a cannula. So now we go there, and now you hold it beautifully well. And sometimes, the hook will distort the iris. It frays the iris. So I would prefer to do that.
And I was unable to understand what happened in the second case. Sushil, can you give me your viewpoints? When did it the zonular dehiscence happen, and what was the reason here?
So probably the size of the nucleus was too big, and the size of my rexis was not that adequate to collapse the
nucleus. No, my thing was the way you're mobilizing the nucleus out. You need to be a little bit more slow, a little bit more gentle, because the rexis size was quite good enough. As far as I was seeing it, it looked quite good enough. If I just go back and play it here again, the rexis is almost 6 millimeter. And with 6 millimeter, you can get most of the nucleus out. I think now when you do this, this is a situation you may end up catching the rexis margin with your dialer itself. That could be one of the reasons why you're having this zonular dehiscence, because the rexis margin was quite big enough. Maybe the staining was not high enough for you to appreciate the rexis margin, because I would find it difficult to have a zonular dehiscence with this size rexis here.
I think you'll have to go back and check whether the instrument is actually exerting its force on the capsular bag, the edge of the rexis, at some point of time. Maybe you can.
This is the area where you had put it here, and you started the rotation at this area itself. Maybe I think, Sushil, the take-home message for you would be abandon the uni hand technique of maneuvering the nucleus out. You've got excellent skills. just practice the bimanual technique of nucleus prolapsing into the anterior chamber. Because if you can master that, you can manipulate the nucleus in the very smaller sized rexus as well. So that would be the take home message.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Sir.
And also, I feel that visco expression scenario, unless the wound is very, very weak, it is very difficult to get it out. Otherwise, there will be so much of pressure behind the nucleus, into the bag before the nucleus gets delivered. Sushil, you are comfortable doing it all the time?
Usually I decide. Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
So if the size of my tunnel is big, I usually prefer to do a visco expression.
No, you can always make it big. That means you always do visco expression.
Majority of the time, sir.
Okay. How did you come to accept that technique?
So because during my residency or during my this thing, I like this sandwich technique, and with the vectis, I have ended up with endothelial damages. So I feel my postoperative corneas are quite clear with the visco expressions than doing with the irrigating vectis and using two instruments for my nucleus delivery.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
Dr. Sushil, do you remove the capsular bag ultimately when you are putting this lens, or do you keep the capsular bag also?
No, sir, I keep a capsular bag. I don't remove.
Would they, in your experience, would they falsify later? Because doing a yard laser for a torn capsular bag is pretty difficult. There is no trampoline effect there. Would you like to? It doesn't serve any purpose there. Your hyaluronal phase is intact. You have succeeded in not herniating the, and not breaking the anterior vitreous phase. What work is it? Anyway, there is a right trial port for the anterior chamber to posterior chamber to communicate. Any good reason why you are keeping the capsular bag there?
It's Cristiano Ronaldo.
Sushil?
Hello, yes, sir.
Sushil, yeah. Sir is asking something.
So usually what happens is during our learning curve and all, managing the case itself is a very big thing for us to... Completing the case itself is a big thing for us. So I didn't remove the bag. So I will try to do that now.
Yeah, maybe I'll answer for you. Your thought process would be, vitreous is not disturbed. If I want to remove the bag, maybe I would disturb the vitreous again. So I would want to close it as early as possible.
Why to complicate?
Yeah. So maybe your thought process was like that. I want to get out of the case as early as possible. So, okay, that's acceptable. But I think in the next 1 month or so, we would see that you would be doing all these things comfortably well. I'm sure you are an excellent surgeon and you can master them, all of them. Congratulations and thank you for sharing your case. I must compliment you for your excellent technique of iris claw lens. It looked flawless the way you implanted it. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, I have a question for Deepak, sir. Mm-hmm. Sir, what in that first case, we don't have a CTR with us. We still go in and put a rigid lens, and it was just less than 3 clock hertz. So positioning the IL in such a way that the haptic goes into the place where there is a zonular dialysis, could that be ideal? Or placing a sulcus lens?
No, in the back placement with the haptic supporting that area is good, but it is not ideal, because what happens when you're trying to put the lens, you are going to maneuver. Maneuvering this haptic into that position is going to be traumatic. Okay. So it's going to extend the iliar joint. You should be extremely lucky to get it, the haptics in that place in the first shot itself. Okay. So it is not ideal, but you can get through it once and for all. It's always better than putting a sulcus lens, but the ideal would be first give a 360 degree support to the bag by putting a ring and then putting a lens. That's okay.
And before even going for the iris claw lens, sulc, we can place the lens in the sulcus.
Yeah, you can do that. But as Ravindra sir said, that you know, when you have a folded bag, folded PC, it's going to be a caps. Opacification is going to be an issue, and you are going to again YAG it after that. You can still do that. That also is an option, acceptable option.
Usually, like sometimes, like when we don't have a correct IOL or multi-piece IOL or something to place in sulcus. What we used to do in our residency days, right? So we can leave patient aphakic at that point in time. If this thing, back dialysis is less than 3 clock hours, after like about 4 to 6 weeks, the bag itself acts as a ring or something like that. It will be more fibrous, but still it will be transparent. So we can still go ahead with a in sulcus placed IOL for that.
Okay, accepted.
But you have promised IOL, so that part is there.
That's all.
And one more thing, I think we should we make it a point to stay in the entry chamber with the tricot before leaving, putting the lens, after putting the lens.
Absolutely. You have to confirm
it. There's always a component of invisible vitreous. So even vitreoretinal surgeons cannot make out sometimes. So whenever there is a disturbance in like bag or any subluxation intraoperatively, it is always better to reconfirm it with tricot. That is like we usually do 1 in 5 dilution, then inject the tricot. We can give a like proper wash after that also. And while giving wash also, it's always better to consider not to consider like continuous flow IA. We can just go with some loop or something.
See, there are a lot of techniques where the pre-chop technique is very popular in fake emulsification, where the nucleus is chopped. It's very easy. There are a lot of gadgets available. There are a couple of them are from Indian inventors. I can't remember the name, but there is one person who has invented a beautiful chopper. And how relevant it is to chop the nucleus in the capsular bag before you take it out into the anterior chamber. Dr. Deepak would like to highlight, and because I don't know whether your experience in pre-chop, manual pre-chops, can kindly summarize this.
Right, this pre-chop, and for when you're doing SICS, I usually bring the whole nucleus en masse and then maybe try to bisect it in the anterior chamber. I never try it into the capsular bag. We can try that. We can always use that. Then Akaoshi pre-chopper is there, but I have never had any personal experience with it. But we are having one session in our meeting, FACO fracture, where Dr. Ravindra sir is going to do it on entire session on that, and maybe Dr. Sundaram Shetty. So we'll discuss that on your next segment, FACO section or FACO fracture technique.
Anybody else? Who are attending this would like to say something, comment, clarify. Dr. Ranjit?
I would like to add my and our experience of nucleus management, which many would find bizarre, I would say. And if you allow, can I share a video for 2 minutes? Hello. Deepak, can you?
Yeah, I'm just sure.
Unshare.
Yeah, I'm just sure. Sorry.
It's 10:19. We are 19 transcribers. Close up. Even after this. Ranjit, you're sharing?
I'm trying to share it. But I'm not getting that particular video. Okay. Can you see the video now?
No, we see the folders.
Okay.
In the meantime, anybody else want to say anything?
Sir, next week's meeting, I am decided the thing. Dr. Chetan is going to present his video on managing a soft cataract, difficulties in managing a soft cataract. And MSR sir is going to talk on replace fracture technique.
I'll be able to share my video now. Just a second. Just 2 minutes of it. Pupil is constricted and we just tumble the nucleus out of the bag and the bring it into the anterior chamber. And like we were talking about visco expression, it's been a way of life for us throughout. This was a very hard black cataract. I'll show you an immature cataract. And at most of the places where I've been showing this technique, well, the majority find it very bizarre. So I use this word frequently. But visco expression with a big tunnel is very convenient and gives us a very clear, crystal clear cornea the next day. The next part is in slow motion, but I think I just wanted to share this part of it. And your comments, Dr. Ravindra, please.
Excellent. I think you aptly mentioned high company. Okay. I think we need to conclude because the past moment is closing at 10 o'clock.
Yes.
We'd like to conclude this so that we can meet again. This is a beautiful stuff that's coming up, getting very popular. And we learned today that Rexis has to be done. And Rexis is the proportion by the size of nucleus. Nucleus doesn't have a bit on top, even not the width of it, but it is what you need to assess. How hard is the nucleus? Rotation into the anterior chamber is very important. The damage to the zonules will occur at that point of time. Two beautiful videos shown demonstrated that. And then damage to endothelial markers when you're taking it out from the anterior chamber out of the eye. And again, a lot of points were discussed. I think with these, Dr. Deepak, would you like to add on anything before we conclude? You can unmute.
I would request Pradeep to give some concluding remarks.
Sir, Dr. Shetty has to answer my question yet, sir.
I think it's time we'll discuss next time. We have promised something to keep in time.
Yeah, I will remember to answer that on the hard cataract, where to put the vectis. Right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Next time. First thing is that next time.
Because most of them end up pulling the, you know, the iris and then it is a mess. So I just want to talk about it, sir.
Yeah. Next time.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I'll show you a video.
Yes, sir.
Pradeep.
Yes, sir. Thank you one and all. And today we had a important discussion on the 5 Pearls of Rexis by Sundaram Shetty sir. And then we had a nucleus management by Dev Prasad and excellent video presentation by Sushil Kakandki on zonular dialysis during nucleus management. And we'll continue the same things next week.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.